Good evening. I fought that urge to say good morning, but it is good evening. I'm glad that you all could be here with us tonight. Thank you for braving the cold and the dicey road conditions out there just to spend a little time with us in worship. And welcome to everybody who's joining us online. Just very quickly, our service tonight's just a little bit different than your normal church service, is that we're going to tell the Christmas story. The use of scripture and some songs, and all the songs will be on the screen, and we want to invite you to sing along with them. If you don't know them all or you don't like them all, then sing the ones you like. Jump in wherever you want to. We just want you to be a part of the experience tonight, to be a part of the worship service, so we invite you to jump in wherever you feel comfortable. We usually get started with our service with saying the Apostles' Creed, so if you all wouldn't mind, please, let's stand and the words will be on the screen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead, He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. Be seated, please.
As we celebrate the birth of Jesus and rejoice in His coming to us, we light the Christ candle. Jesus Christ is our hope. He is our peace. Jesus Christ is our joy. He is love, pure, holy, undying love. John 3:16 says, "Whoever believes in Him will never perish, but have eternal life." Thanks be to God for His indescribable gift. 2 Corinthians 9:15.
Before we begin, I want to offer just a word of prayer, but there's just a couple of things to mention. If y'all didn't notice, Terry and Linda Skinner are missing tonight. Linda's been sick all week, but evidently Terry had a fever this afternoon of 102, so I'm sure they're getting the flu bug that's making its way around to everybody. And of course, we want to remember all of our prayer concerns on the back of our bulletin. And remember those who... maybe lonely tonight. Maybe they don't have friends and family to celebrate with. Remember the homeless who are probably looking for some place to warm up tonight. So there's a lot that we have as people to be grateful for. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we just want to say thank you. We thank you for the opportunity to come together in this beautiful facility, this place that we call Bethany. It's a place where we can gather in comfort and warmth, and we can celebrate you, the gift, the blessing you gave to the world so many years ago, what it has done for humanity, the depths of which may never be uncovered. So I would just pray tonight that we could be in this moment, that at least for this hour or so that we are all here together, that we could shut out that outside world, that we could lay our concerns and our anxieties and even the worries we have about Christmas and trying to make everything just right. If we could just lay all that aside for just a minute and just be present right here, right now, in this moment. That the scriptures that are read, the story that is told here tonight, let that just nourish our spirits, nourish our souls. Because I think whatever we come to this place of worship, whenever we come here, we may have things on our mind, things of the world, concerns of family and friends, and all that we do as humans. But we come here looking for one thing, and that's a connection with our Lord and Savior. We want to make that connection here. We want to feel that Holy Spirit just consume us and give us that feeling of peace and comfort and joy. All that this season of Advent represents. And it culminates here tonight. So may your Spirit be with us. May it preside over this worship experience, and may it touch our hearts. And if you would say with me that the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples long ago, as we say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Thank you all. This Christmas Eve message that we've prepared tonight, I'm calling it Great Expectations. Because for me, this is a time of year that is, it's filled with wonder. It's filled with excitement. It's filled with anticipation. And yes, there are some great expectations about not just this night, but about the whole season. When I was young, for me, the excitement would always build when it came time for all of those favorite Christmas specials to come on TV. It was a time, it was a while ago. It was a time before cable TV. It was a time before such things as DVD players, even a time before videotape, where you had to wait for it to come on the network television. We didn't get to see it at our pleasure. We would always watch the little TV guide that came in the local newspaper, and you'd have to just see when your favorite show would air, and I can remember how exciting it was to pick up the newspaper and finally see Rudolph Friday night, 8 o'clock. And we planned for that all week. But when the Christmas specials were over, then came my favorite time of year. This was school was out for a couple of weeks. That was always the greatest Christmas gift to me. But I guess we all have those cherished childhood memories, and hopefully you've continued to make those memories as an adult, because it is such a special time of year. And I think as people, somehow we just know there's something different about this time of year. I hear people sometimes say, "Well, there's just something special in the air during Christmas time. Somehow people seem to smile a little more. They seem a little more relaxed. They seem to be a little bit calmer. And people just want to get together. They just want to get together with their family and friends. They want to celebrate and probably eat too much, eat too many cookies and candies and fudge or whatever else it is, and just be with your family and friends and just relax and enjoy the season, if it's only just for a little while. But we want to soak all that in. So tonight I invite you to kind of just be present in this moment, to look past all the secular influence that's out there in the world, all the commercialism that we all know is associated with Christmas. Look beyond our lights and our trees. See past all your seasonal parties. Set aside your stress and anxiety of trying to just make that perfect Christmas happen. We all do it. Wrapping presents, preparing meals and everything just to be so-so. And we get worried about who's going to make it to the family get-together and who's not. And will the roads be passable? Put all that aside and just listen to the story of the prophecy that God's promised Messiah was finally born into the world. It's hard for us to realize because we're used to that. It's hard for us to realize how long that was anticipated. For generations, people talked about this coming Messiah, but for us, it's kind of old hat. We talk about it every year. For generations, people told, the prophets told, of the one who was coming who would be king, the Savior of God's people. And people had great expectations of what this king might do, who he might be, what he might accomplish. I think most people thought that God's Savior was going to come and what we would expect, somebody who would come and is going to conquer the world, would come as a great warrior. He would fight great battles. In the traditional sense, we think about that, but God had his own plans. You see, God's Savior came into the world and he would not fight with sword and shield. He would fight hate with love. And the battle was not fought to occupy land or possessions or worldly treasures. The battle was a spiritual one. And what God wants to possess is our hearts. And what he offers us is something greater than any worldly treasure you could ever imagine. And that is an eternal life with him. When Jesus was born, a great light came into this world. A great light that would just dispel the darkness. Listen to the words of the prophet Isaiah from chapter 9. The people walking in the darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the deep land of darkness, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. The government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. The coming of this Savior was generations in the making. And I bet people gave up. Worse, I bet people lost hope waiting on God's timing. How are you all both waiting on God's timing? I know we're all, as humans, we're just impatient. We're impatient people. We get anxious. We all experience our doubts. But there was always a plan. God always had a plan from the very beginning, from John's Gospel, chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. In him was life. And that life was the light of all mankind. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The coming of this long-awaited Savior is revealed to his mother Mary and his earthly father Joseph by an angel. This is no ordinary story. And what this has meant to humanity perhaps will never be measured. It's a story when God came to earth in the form of a small, innocent baby. But he came for a reason. He came for a purpose. He came not to fulfill the expectations of people, but to fulfill the prophecy of his Father. He was to be the Savior of the world to all people. This is no ordinary story, but I would suggest it's the greatest story ever told. From Luke's Gospel, chapter 1. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will call him Jesus. He will be great. He will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her.
Yeah.
From Matthew's Gospel, chapter 1. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother, Mary, was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet he did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet: "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and he took Mary home as his wife. Luke's Gospel, chapter 2. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. Thank you. from Luke's Gospel, chapter 2. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling cloths, laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Jesus was born. The prophecy had been fulfilled. And God sent angels to spread the news. This news was not shared with some rich and powerful worldly king or some prominent political figure of the day. No, God sent his angels to make this announcement to lowly shepherds out keeping watch over their fields. From Luke's Gospel, chapter 2. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill toward men.
Joyful all ye nations rise.
So after I shared that last scripture with you and we sang that song, how many of you thought of Charlie Brown Christmas? Come on, Peanuts, it's got a ring in there every time. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 2. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi came from the east to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all of Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was born, where's to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, by no means are the least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went out on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child and his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. They opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.